Hello, everyone. Bonjour. Man, it's fantastic to be here. I'm really excited to get into it. Actually, as of August, I finished my master's program. I graduated in October. We're in October? I don't know. Yeah, I am fully in the PhD program, so I'm really excited to continue on with my studies. So my research interests as of right now include adaptation studies, narrative theory, new media. I did a conference in August about board gaming miniatures. And the narrativity of them. Also, I've got a little bit of Japanese horror cinema mixed in there. Hopefully I can get a publication maybe sitting around. We'll see. But what I want to talk about today is the question of how graphic narratives can use their form to discuss questions of identity, and particularly how neurodegenerative diseases impact identity and allow us to question where our personhood is. So where exactly are we in relation to ourselves? Because when discussing neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's, it brings into question where is our identity? And when a disease like this causes our memories and our recollections to slip away, can someone that suffers from a condition like Alzheimer's have an identity? What does that even mean? And literature is an avenue to approach these questions. And I believe that Sarah Leavitt's graphic memoir, Tangles, A Story About Alzheimer's, My Mother and I, deftly interrogates the intersection of mind, body, environment, and identity by using its graphic form. The text uses the story of Leavitt's mother, Midge, to interrogate a long-standing conception of human identity, the idea that selfhood is a result of the functioning mind, and purely the functioning mind, and that any disruption of the mind causes the complete annihilation of the self. However, despite many panels kind of playing into this same conclusion, Leavitt's text uses its graphic form to construct identity in a different way. Instead of the brain just being an archive of information that either functions or doesn't, identity is instead formed through closure, through synthesis, through the ability to take mental, physical, and environmental images and suture it together to form a cohesive worldview. In the same way that comic books find their meaning in the blank spaces between panels, our own identity is formed through a gestalt of information that the process of closure helps compose. In that sense, Alzheimer's is, instead of one's personhood being deleted, Alzheimer's is rather the inability to form closure with the world around us. It's the inability to link together pieces of disparate information. Midge's identity has not been deleted, it simply had its scope reduced. Now, the way that we think about the human mind has been speculated about for centuries. And really, how we think about identity and personhood is largely a result of our philosophical framework, almost. The frameworks that we use to construct personhood fundamentally impact how we think about ourselves and our relationship to the world around us. For instance, René Descartes insisted that consciousness and the ability to know the world through reason was what made us human. And in fact, he believed that human intellect was elevated above the body, elevated above the material world, and that the human mind was this indivisible thinking substance that was entirely governed by different laws, laws that are separated from the material world. Similarly, Enlightenment philosopher John Locke believed that human personhood also fundamentally rested on mental energy, and that our ability to create a cohesive self relied on our consciousness extending back in time and thinking about our past actions. In this sense, like, our own personhood becomes an archive. We're not a full person if we're not able to recall everything accurately. However, this conception of true selfhood as an accurate mental archive causes problems when discussing people with dysfunctional minds or mental disabilities. This is because the archival mode of personhood threatens to erase our memory if our memory doesn't work properly. And it's in this space that we bring Alzheimer's into the conversation. Now, according to the Alzheimer's Association, Alzheimer's disease is a neurological neurological disease which causes dementia, which is just a general term for memory loss and other cognitive disabilities that interfere with daily life. Now, we aren't 100% sure what exactly causes Alzheimer's, but we're fairly sure that through some process involving structures called plaques and tangles, the nerve cells and the connections between nerve cells are in some way disrupted. And this causes our brain cells to slowly degenerate over time. You'll see here that the brain of an Alzheimer's sufferer has these large holes in it. And these structures cause symptoms like memory failure, personality changes, and general problems going about life. Because neuroscience has problems understanding the mechanisms of Alzheimer's, and to be quite frank, the human mind in general, philosophers must step in. However, as I've discussed, the choice of philosophical framing can really impact how we think about the self. And because of the popular framing of the archive method, Alzheimer's disease threatens to cause almost a living death. Alzheimer's, culturally speaking, is culturally constructed around the metaphor of losing one's mind, of losing one's selfhood. When personhood depends on the brain, and only the brain, to exist, the destruction of your neural functions transforms an Alzheimer's patient into less of a person, into being nothing more than a shell, a vacant body that once contained a person. And this framing of the Alzheimer's person being a former person, an absentee person, is how Tangles, how Leavitt's text, tends to frame the Alzheimer's patient. In Renata Lucia Delmasso's article on Tangles and its depiction of disability, she discusses how the text tends to corroborate the common visual metaphor of losing one's identity through its graphical form. For instance, we have, through the character design of Midge, this the old woman here, the stylized character design allows us to draw a comparison between before and after she was diagnosed, particularly through her expressions. So for instance, on the right, even though Leavitt's text uses very simplistic character design, we can still glean emotions and a complex personhood very accurately. We have the use of eyebrows to suggest whether the character is happy, sad, content. The eyes inside the glasses can be open or closed. Above, it's very clear that that Midge is sad. And below, she is happy, but we can tell that it's kind of a contented, calm kind of happy. Even though the illustrations are simplistic, there is a subtlety to them, a subtlety that suggests a complex personhood. However, as her disease progresses, her visual characterization is taken over by this kind of blank stare that dehumanizes her. It situates her as almost an improper person. As you can see on the right, I apologize for the low resolution images, by the way. The eyebrows, the eyes inside the glasses are gone. They're no longer there. And her expression is overtaken by this slightly downturned frown that suggests a blankness. The deletion of these visual signifiers of emotion and expression suggests that the locus of her identity is starting to break down, that her very personhood is starting to vanish. Another motif that the comic uses to suggest this deletion of personhood is line weight. Earlier, I would say that Midge's physical construction, it's very concrete. Her, especially when you look at her hair. Her hair is made of many strands and is very full and lively. Her body is constructed from these connected lines. However, as the disease progresses, this almost three-dimensionality starts to break down. Her hair has fewer strands. Look, there are gaps kind of in her scalp. Is this a laser pointer? Oh, it is. As you can see, like, her limbs almost start to kind of meld together. There's a gap there. There's a gap there. This wobbly architecture, these disjointed and tenuously constructed lines suggest that she's almost falling apart. As the disease continues to progress, her body becomes nothing more than a single line bleeding into white. Her body, it's almost like she's dissolving. Her expression is nothing more than a single dot, a single unbroken line. These visual qualities suggest that her identity is slowly draining away until nothing but a motionless body remains. It's as if she's already dead. She's already corpse-like because of her disease. However, despite the fact that Tangles frequently uses the imagery of absent personhood, this is not the only reading of this text. In fact, I suggest that Leavitt's text contains a perspective that opposes this problematic notion that identity begins and ends with the mind, by suggesting that personhood is interlinked with the rest of the world. What if personhood isn't just mental? What if our identity is inherently embodied, inherently physical? Now, according to Richard Hiersmink, there's a wealth of data which suggests that memory and identity is not like the archive, but is instead integrative and holistic, a process of narrative. He suggests that personhood is an amalgamation of fragments that are stitched together to form us. We don't just recall information and determine that that's our person, but instead we take actions, objects, individuals, thoughts that surround us, and we use a process called emplotment to shape, organize, and color the raw material of our everyday life into a kind of narrative structure. We live this embodied personhood, which suggests that we aren't just bound to our brain, but we're bound to the rest of the world. And in this sense, our identities are kind of like comic book closure. I swear, that's supposed to be emplotment, not employment. Now, in Scott McCloud's famous text on understanding comics and comic book forms, he suggests that comic books, like our understanding of the world, is necessarily fragmented. We can only see so much of the world. I can't know that my hometown of Waterloo exists when I leave it and when I come here. So I need to make inferences. I need to take the fragments of the world around me and suture them together to perceive them as a whole. These two panels here don't really gain meaning until we connect them in the blank space. I hope I've been speaking directly into the mic this whole time. What Tangle suggests is that Alzheimer's is not the deletion of identity, but is instead a disease which impacts the process of closure, which makes it so that we cannot connect information in the gutter of our own lives. So for instance, there are several scenes which suggests that this process of closure has been interrupted. Over here, Midge recognizes that there is a person in the mirror. She recognizes that there is a fragment there. However, she cannot draw closure with herself, with her recognition that a reflection is herself. Therefore, she talks to the mirror as if it is another person. In another instance, when talking to her daughter, she says, "Will you marry me?" which is something that she used to say to her husband. The information is there. She recognizes that this phrase is a thing that you say to a loved one, but she can't put the pieces together. So there is an error. But the information is still there. It's just that the process of closure has been interrupted. The text also uses this very striking use of pitch black ink to suggest that Midge has almost been divested from herself. Like her head has been sliced off from her body. Metaphorically, she has been fragmented. Over here, there is a scene where Midge starts losing her sense of smell and also her sense of taste. However, instead of this just being something she forgot, Midge starts losing not just her sense of smell, her sense of taste, but her connection to what that means. She loses her connection to the importance of these foods, the connections that spill out, that spread out from food, from cuisine, from the connections made while eating. Her selfhood is being spread out and cut off from itself until it can no longer cohere. And what I think is the most striking example of this disjunction from oneself is this panel right here, when Midge is literally being cut into pieces. In this scene here, Leavitt explains that at around 2001, she heard a song on the radio called Last Resort by Papa Roach, with a lyric saying, "Cut my life into pieces." And overlaid on this is an image of Midge, naked and screaming, sliced into pieces by black lines of ink. This chapter depicts her as being in pieces, as being estranged from herself. However, we have to remember that Alzheimer's in this construction isn't a form of deletion. Even though Midge is fragmented, the pieces are all still there. I think the fundamental question that Leavitt's text asks is, where is she? Where is Midge? Where are we? What can be said about us when something impacts our memories so much? And the answer to this depends on how we frame identity and how we frame selfhood. Of course, if we only think of personhood as being in the mind, as being our ability to recall information, we are going to consider Midge as being lost, as being a walking corpse. However, if we broaden our definition of identity and consider identity as being relational, as being a process of synthesis, as being a sum total of our minds, bodies, and the relationships we have with other people in the physical world, then the framing of diseases like Alzheimer's, and really the framing of how we see ourselves, changes. Instead of Alzheimer's causing an absence of identity, it causes an impairment of identity. And this is an important distinction. The latter reading insists that those with Alzheimer's are, in one way or another, still people who deserve to be loved and taken care of. Alzheimer's may have fractured Midge, but the pieces are still there, and those pieces deserve to be seen as human. Thank you.